like the ripple on the water, sends a message to the shore. So I know forever after I will miss you more and more. It won't be easy.
No,
it won't be easy without you.
No, no.
Time Crim set out to smear my good name.
Yes, with some success, wouldn't you say?
Listen, you pommy one-minute wonder. I was just stringing him along so that I could add attempting to bribe an officer to all the other counts I'd got him on.
I'm very convincing you were too, ex-officer Kinsey.
You set me up.
Doesn't take much to him when they're as greedy as you are.
This is Inspector Davis, one of our more recent recruits.
Formerly Detective Chief Inspector Davis, till a woman cost me my job. She's doing time now. When in doubt, head straight for the top.
Don't count on it, Spring.
Not a bad-looking woman for all that, wouldn't you say? Sorry, we've not been introduced, not properly. Colin Davis, we did meet briefly.
Well, I personally have found out that the moon is not made of green cheese and that Father Christmas don't live on the dark side.
Were you testing me as well?
I can tell you now, it's as straight as a die.
Butt out, Jack! When I want a character reference from you, I'll ask for one, all right?
It's Colin.
My name is Trevor Cooper, and I played Colin Davis in Star Cops.
I'm very cuddly when you get to know me.
I got involved with the project via Graham Harper, who was one of the directors on Star Cops. I did an episode of Doctor Who for him, Revelation of the Daleks. And then he was doing a stage show, which I did. I can't remember the name of the show now, but it was about we all had to dress up in school uniforms and be little boys in a room above a pub in Chelsea. And while we were doing that, he said to me, oh, by the way, Travis, said, I'm doing this new sci-fi series and I put you forward for it because I think you'd be dead right for one of the characters. And luckily, that's, you know, that's how it all came about.
That's going to cost you your job.
Yeah, I know. I was thinking of asking you for one.
I met the producer and the other director, Chris Baker, and got the job, thankfully. The series was rushed quite a bit. We did have some problems about making it. I remember just on my own part, I was doing a show in Manchester during the rehearsals for the first studio block, and the studio block started like the day after I finished this show. So I would get up at 6 o'clock in Manchester, or 5 o'clock, get the 6 o'clock train from Manchester to London, get a tube over to Acton where we were rehearsing, rehearse for 3 or 4 hours, then get back on the train and then go and do a show. So I was doing that for about 3 or 4 weeks, I think. So I was a bit tired. And then I just think it was one of those things that it was almost like we were doing it before we knew we were. And there were all sorts of decisions that hadn't been made about how the thing should look. And it was almost like we were making them up as we went along, you know, which meant that some of them didn't settle till sort of later on in the series, and that some of the earlier episodes we were still sort of finding our way, you know. But for example, in the first episode there is, and I think in the second episode too, there is some sort of flying, you know. There was a basic amount of gravityless atmosphere where we are supposedly floating about, which was done with a Kirby's flying harness in front of some sort of blue screen, you know. And, you know, we could do it up to a point, but it looked a bit strange. And so I think quite early on they decided, well, we're not going to do that anymore. And it was just after that, it was just accepted that there was never a zero gravity situation, you know, or whatever it was. I think there was only one episode, or maybe two, when I actually had to wear an astronaut suit. And I remember it being extremely stuffy and just being very difficult to get about it. Also things like, I remember we were doing our first studio and they bought an American astronaut, and I can't remember the man's name. He was the man who was in charge of the shuttle. He was still in the shuttle on the second Apollo mission that got to the moon. which was Al Bean was the guy that went on them, and I can't remember this man's name for the life of me, but he was the man in the shuttle. And he was brought in for the day into the studio just to sort of help us, you know, to talk about what it was like going to the moon. And there were certain things that it was the episode with a space shuttle going to the moon, and he said, well, because there was no sort of gravity in the thing, all our hair would stand on end, and we'd be sitting asleep like that with our arms sort of floating upwards. So I think there's still scenes, not having seen it for a bit, there are scenes in that episode where we're all sitting like that with hair like Ken Dodd. So, I mean, I think probably one of the reasons we both got on very well was that we're both very much from sort of theatre backgrounds. We both had a lot of sort of rep experience. I mean, and David, you know, when I was started out doing rep, theatre rep, a lot of it in the North, David was a sort of hero. I mean, he was one of the great Northern rep actors before he started going into television. And we just sort of got on, and you know, right from the start, I mean, through that, I mean, we both had a very similar approach. And we both were very conscious that we wanted to make scripts work before we necessarily started rehearsing them technically. They had to make sense. And sometimes, you know, there was an awful lot we had to do, you know. I'm not saying that the scripts were lacking in anything, but sometimes it just needed that a little bit of tadging here and there, you know. And as most of the other cast members are all different sort of nationalities and things coming in, you know, we tended to be the two that did a lot of that, you know. But generally, I mean, it was a very close cast, actually. You know, we all got on very well all the time. I mean, that's not just me being diplomatic. I can't remember there ever being, you know, any problems between us. Linda was fantastic, who played Pal, who was Australian, who'd come over specifically to do that. And she's got this extraordinary vocabulary. She's a bit like Barry Humphries. She's got all this sort of Barry McKenzie stuff. She'll actually say, that guy's got, you know, he's too chopped short of a babby, and things like that. And there were a few expressions I'd not heard before. There was one for, if you were, someone was a bit mad, she'd say, oh, he's got ruse loose in his top paddock, was one of hers. And the other one, which I still use to this day, that we had a scene at the end of an episode where there'd been, something quite dramatic had happened, and there's a scene in the office at the end, which is sort of quite downbeat and quite comic. And she said, oh, no, what this is a dog barks and everyone laughs scene. And we said, what do you mean by that? And he said, well, she said, you always used to see it in Starsky and Hutch. She said, there'd be incredible mayhem, bodies all over the place. And then there'd be a little quiet scene, a sort of slightly humorous scene in the guy's office. And someone would say, well, that was Sunday, wasn't it, Snowy? And they'd turn to the dog, and the dog would go, rah, rah, and everyone would laugh, and there'd be a freeze frame. And you suddenly remembered, yes, those scenes happened all the time in that thing. And we had, so I've often entirely done dog barks and everyone laughs scenes. You see them in Star Wars all the time. What do you think, R2? Blah, 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 blah. Everyone laughs. Credits, you know. Graham was terrific. I'd worked with him before, on the Doctor Who and on the theatre show. The thing about Graham worked his way up from, I mean, when he started off at the BBC, he was a sort of call assistant. He used to sort of knock on the actor's door to say, we're ready to shoot your shot, you know. And I think he'd done every job in between that and being a director. So he just knows the floor of a studio or indeed a film set or whatever, inside out. And his enthusiasm is absolutely extraordinary. He's funny, and he just gets everyone going, all right, Gov, it's all this, and where are we? Cool, we guess now, that's great. And that rubs off. I mean, and you know, and he thinks and thinks and thinks about what he's going to do. For example, when he came in, I think, on episode 4 or 3, I can't remember, and he suddenly said, well, he said, he got worried about the fact that the whole thing looked slightly overlit, that it looked like what it was, which was, a studio set inside, you know, TV centre. And he went in and he went to the head of lighting at the studios and he said, I want all the lights out. He said, I want it lower. And they kept putting it lower. And said, no, lower than that. I said, no, it's never been lower than that. I said, I don't care. I want it lower than that. And so the level of the lights was incredibly low. And so most of the light that was coming from computer screens. And it meant that it was far more atmospheric. It started to look a bit more like, you know, the interior of a film like Alien or something like that. And it just worked. It just took slightly the curse off, oh, you know, we're in a BBC studio. And he was constantly doing inventive things like that. He was always thinking ahead. He's technically one of the best directors I've ever worked for. And, you know, and he's also very good with actors too. He's just, you know, gives you a lot of stuff. No, he's great fun. The thing about it was, for me, you have to remember that it was the first regular part I'd done in a television. So for me, it was like a huge break. I thought, little did I know. But that, you know, I'd done quite a lot of telly. I mean, I'd only been, I came into acting quite late. So I was 25 before I did my first job, 26 really. So I'd only been doing it for about 4 or 5 years, I suppose. And it was the first time I'd had a regular in a series. So I was incredibly excited. And, you know, you're on sort of proper money, you know, and starting off a new thing, which if it takes off, you know, you could be doing it for, you know, 10 years or something and become horribly famous and end up on blankety blank, you know. So I was, yeah, so I was very excited by it all. And Davis too, I mean, he's a bit rougher and harder and heavier than I am in real life. I think not quite as bright as I am. But at the same time has a certain degree of nous and is, you know, a London copper, you know, and I'm, you know, I was born in London. I've lived most of my life in London apart from a few years in Brighton. And I like the fact that he was very foot on the ground copper, ironically, because we're not actually on the earth, we're on the moon, you know. To me, I was like saying, well, what I want to do is play it as this guy who could quite easily be in The Bill, but actually, although The Bill wasn't going on, I don't think, but anyway, but who actually happens to be on the moon. You know, he's a policeman who happens to happen to be posted somewhere else other than he would be. So you don't suddenly start acting differently because you're on the moon. You're just, you know, a normal London copper who happens to be in a slightly different posting. That was all. And so there are all sorts of things. For example, the costume woman, Linda, whose name I can't remember now, but Linda had said, you know, she'd said, oh, we've got these are the sort of outfits. She said, it'd be really nice, wouldn't it, to have something that was very much from home, that was very clearly not something that you'd have specially bought to go to the moon with. It would actually be, so there was this old grey sweater that I think her mum had knitted for her ex-husband or something. And she said, this would be, I said, that's brilliant. So I often had, you know, whereas everybody else had, you know, I mean, we had these sort of jumpsuits and, you know, space type costumes. Quite a lot of the time I'd have this terrible old grey sweater, which we nicknamed Dennis, which had sort of holes in the elbows and things like that, you know. And so it's just to sort of, so I was always up for sort of bringing out the sort of, you know, the down to earthness of him, even though he happened to be on the moon. That was my main thing. And also, I mean, there were occasionally one was given lines where he would be racist, sexist. You know, if any of the characters were going to come out with that sort of thing, it was going to be him. But, you know, I think we all thought that, you know, if he ever did that, he had to be firmly put in his place. He wasn't allowed to get away with it, which I think quite important.
Do you know what we're looking for? Three bloody embryos, three little tadpoles.
Yeah, well, it's the honour of the force that's at stake, Colin. I mean, it doesn't look very good having a kidnap on your own doorstep.
It was not a kidnap. She probably flushed the things down a bloody loo. What I don't understand is what a silly bitch had to have it done on the moon.
Of course, the chances of conception are doubled at low gravity.
It amazes me, the things you know.
Well, considering your one-track mind, it amazes me the things you don't know.
Everyone laughs. Credits, you know. But in terms of, you know, some of the scripts, I mean, John Colley's script was a fantastic script. And both Phil and Chris wrote, there wasn't a script that I, you know, didn't like and didn't think it was like a really good story. And the characters were pretty vividly drawn, and it was all sort of, you know, nationalities. And so part of me obviously was surprised and a little shocked that it wasn't the hit that it should have been, you know. We had a good time on it, actually. It was a good laugh. It's a series I enjoyed doing. Funny old world.